Sign once again for the real people, multi-game sellers here at Megatuner. So at the terminus of our last game, which was Cities of Kerez, Fallen Cities of Kerez, I think, I decided that I wanted to do a game about with city in the title, because I thought, you know, we went from Falling Sky to Fallen City of Kerez, why not then move on with the city word, because I don't think there's another game with Kerez in the title. And so I thought for not very long, and I came up with the Cities game. I read about the Cities game, and it's basically kind of like a negotiation game, but each negotiation thing seems to be over a certain event. Like there's a card that lists some things that have happened in the city, and then the four major powers of the city, which are the agitators, the slum dwellers, the business, and the government, kind of decide whether how they want to deal with that thing. Okay. However, the result is always the same. It has to do with like how successful the vote is, or like what the votes are, and whether or not there's a riot or police action that happens. And so the event itself didn't seem to do anything. It didn't seem to matter. You could just have a number saying this is vote number one. And I, unless I'm reading it wrong. I mean, I read it late at night, and it could be I was reading it wrong. But that made me want to have something for that to matter, okay? So I decided to... I was looking at my other city games. So I have Our Town, which isn't city, but it's Our Town. And... That had a little bit, but this one had a little bit more urban sprawl. So I think how we're going to do it is we're going to just Frankenstein a game together, see if it works, who knows. And when the votes happen, that's going to have an effect on urban sprawl. Okay, and urban sprawl, if you're not aware of it, it's a game where you make this very abstract kind of city. We're going to de-abstract it a little bit by adding Our Town to it. So we're gonna actually have kind of three concurrent games that are layered on each other with players that are separate in the different games. There's some overlap, however, in like how they can affect things, and also in terms of how the games affect each other. So obviously the Cities game is gonna have a pretty direct effect on the sprawl, which is where the people in Our Town are going to be living. So Our Town we're not going to actually use the board in that. And I don't think I'm even going to use the named properties, just because urban sprawl, it works so hard to make its buildings generic after they're put into play. So how that game works is you build a building and it'll have a one-time effect, but then basically from then on the building is only defined by color and size. It's not going to matter what it is. And so I'm going to just kind of stick with that, so I don't have to put all these markers on the board or try to remember what building is what, with a few exceptions, because it's going to be important to know where the Our Town people live, and it's going to be important to know where they get their news. And I decided just for fun to add another kind of element, and that's going to be the newsboy. And I'll just talk about that once we have everything set up. So I'll go set up now, and then we'll play our game and see if it's not a disaster.
Okay, so here we are set up. And this might be a lot for you to take in. We've got a lot of real people participating in this here game. Oh, one of them fell down. Oftentimes when I walk by the table, a real person will fall down. So we, as I said before, we have three games combined. We have the Cities game. Primary players of that game are going to be Dancing Bear, Chinky, Vaughn, and Sunny back there. Okay, so Dancing Bear, she's going to be a voting member of the business area. These people here, we have Stubby, Giraffe, Pinky, and Junior, are also going to be voting for business. They are also the players of this game here, Urban Sprawl. So I already went through a turn for them. Pretty enjoyable game. There's a lot to think about with it in terms of placement and things like that. Lots of dimensions. That's fun. So they're going to be playing that game. Money is freely transferable between everyone in the game, even though we're using three different currencies. Just a little bit of division, taking off of zeros, can kind of make them all the same. So when a big event comes up, business is going to decide what they do. and they can either vote for it, one, vote for it, three, or vote for it not at all. And what they eventually decide is going to be voted on between these five here, Dancing Bear, and then the four Urban Sprawl players. Okay, Chinky here, he's the government player for the city's game, and he has a different spread of votes. There you can see what everyone has. He could do one in favor, zero, or police action. And you can vote multiple things, so he could vote one and police action. However, in Urban Sprawl, they are able to get the influence of different politicians. So right now, Pinky has influence of the mayor, so she's going to get some votes on that as well. I think he gets a solid vote, and she'll get, it'll be like proportional for them, maybe, is how I'll do it. I don't know. But mayor would be worth more than the other political jobs. So they'll decide how that works. So she's going to get to decide, have a say in the business faction as well as the government faction. Because really, those factions are pretty tied up. It's kind of a power faction, a power coalition. Then we have the powerless coalition. We have the Agitators, who is headed up by Vaughn. She's also going to be voting with Hair Bear and Desi right there. They start the game off homeless. So if you look here, down here, we have, this is Flush's house, and this is Banana's house. They don't have a house yet. So they're going to be voting with her. Then Flush and Banana, they're the slum dwellers. I guess these are slums, although they've become quite high value through play because Pinky was able to up the value with this and this. So they're not quite so much slums anymore. Not that that really helps them. They are renters, so the rent is going to be higher. And I could see how that would make them want to maybe riot. Riot is a voting option that both the Agitators and the slum dwellers have. I don't know if I should probably zoom in on that. There are all their voting options on the big events. Now, those don't come up very often. In Urban Sprawl, each of these decks, there's a town deck, a city deck, and a metropolis deck, which I just didn't bother to put out yet, has a card in it that's, it says like airport, sports team, the Olympics. And that's like a big thing that if you pass that, you move up to the next level. It just so happens that coincides with this game here, the city's game. If you pass a vote, you go to the first rewards and everyone gets something, second rewards, third rewards. And if you pass the third vote, you go to Future City. So how we're going to be doing it is when the airport comes up, they're not actually going to be voting on an airport because who cares? Who cares about a sports team? Who cares about the Olympics? They don't matter. What does matter is if we move towards Future City. So in order to go from town to city, to start using the city deck, they have to pass this vote on town. So it'll be the same on there. Okay? If that doesn't happen, it'll get shuffled back in or something, and we'll just keep playing. This is an experiment. We don't know how things are going to turn out. I might be changing things as we go along. That's just kind of how you have to do it. All right, so we have our city's players in the back row. We have our Urban Sprawl players over here, and then we have two sections of our town game there. All right. Then we also have Smudge. Smudge is the paper boy. The newspaper got built, so he's going to be able to start playing. It's right there. And his job is going to be to go around and try to sell papers to people. Every time he sells a paper, he gets $50. He's just going for personal best score. I'll probably see how he's doing and compare it with his score up there to see what happens to him. He also kind of determines, so the newspaper will invoke these cards here. And so he's gonna kind of determine what that means. So it'll be like, oh, this factory is in trouble. So which factory, there's two kind of industrial buildings out there, which one is the newspaper talking about? We're going under the premise that the newspaper is telling the truth. And so we have to figure out through Smudge how that truth is going to affect this town. Kind of similarly to my role with these, which are the big events that people are going to have to pass to move up cities. I hope that's not too complicated for you to understand. I'll just give you a breakdown on this Urban Sprawl game. These cubes here are control cubes. If you have control of something and that number comes up, so you see there's numbers over here. These red numbers are points. Yellow numbers are money. That comes up, a payout's going to go in that column or row. So if the five came up, you'd see who has the most buildings in the five zone, and they get the highest payout. And right here, it's clearly going to, it would be Stubby, Okay, so he would get all $5, and that's it. And that's the main way you get points. You get compensated more by building colors next to other colors. So if you there's a yellow building, you put a yellow building next to it. That's good. To build buildings, you need money, and you also need to get permits, and you also need the contract to do it. So you kind of need three components to do that. Contracts and permits are gotten by spending action points. You get 6 per turn, and they're just listed on there, and these will slide down as the turn when turns end. And then you can also get money by selling these cards off at the start of your turn. So then the number would be the number down there. And that's kind of the basics of the game. The different buildings have different effects as well, but I'm going to try to not get too in the weeds on that. Cities game, I kind of already explained. Our town is kind of like Monopoly, but it's a communist Monopoly type game. So in that game, you have these different properties you can get, but you can either have them be personally owned, in which you just pay for it, and this would be a development on that property, or you can have it be cooperatively owned. And if it's cooperatively owned, everyone has to pay for it. Otherwise, you go around, you have to pay rent on things you don't own or that are not cooperatively owned. Supposedly a cooperative game. I'm thinking about having it be semi-cooperative. I don't know. I think if someone gets bankrupt, they're just out. I think we're going to have it be semi-cooperative, so they can all kind of essentially win together, or, one person can fail. But if one person fails, they don't all fail. Just because, I don't know. And so, how are they going to be moving around the board? So I guess we'll do one right now. So here's Hair Bear. It's a roll and move game. The rules, oddly, are unclear to whether or not you roll 1 or 2 dice. I'm going to be using 2 dice because it just works better for my purposes. And I think that's what's intended, because 2 dice do come with the game. So you got an 11. Okay, so you can go 1, 2. A corner is counted as a space. And the reason why is if it's odd, you can turn left. And if it's even, you can turn right. Okay? So it has to be a space in order for that to work. And if you started on a corner, you can start off any direction that you want. Okay, 11. So he could go this way. That's not that appealing to him. He's trying to find a home or something. I don't know exactly what he's trying to do. So 3, 4, 5. I think he'll just keep going towards the heart of town. 6. He also might want to get a job. 7, 8, 9. So he could go 10, 11 and stop there. 10, 11, stop here. Or if he had turned over here, it'd be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Stop there. 9, 10. Yeah, well, you can't go that way. I think he'll just keep going this way. What was that? 9, 10, 11. So he's going to stop there. Nothing happens. There's no buildings next to him, so he doesn't have to pay anything. But he also doesn't really get anything either. We can move right on to Desi. He's purple. 8. These are just wanderers who have come to town. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So he could go here and go to the government offices. He would have to either purchase them, I guess. It kind of breaks down. Like, how are you buying the courthouse and things like that? I don't know. I guess we don't want to think too hard about that. I guess you just become a landlord and the government is paying you for it. I don't know. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and he got 8, 7, 8. So he could go there. Then he's going to have to purchase something and maybe try to get a job. 7, 8. Or he could go forward and deal with 2 smaller things. Well, let's look at the value on these are really high, so to purchase them would be kind of expensive. So I think he'll go up here. By value, I should explain something. How rents and things are determined is just purely by the yellow. Purely by the yellow. And then if they buy it, the builders still get to get prestige payouts, but they will no longer get money payouts for them because they're purchased. So I'm going to stop the camera so these fellows can talk about whether they want to buy things cooperatively or if, you know, Desi's just going to buy it himself or if he's just going to pay rent. Okay, so how it shook out was Desi decided to get a job here as a travel agent. He has a lot of experience in Hawaii, if you remember the careers game. And so he was able to use that to get a job. He did also have to pay rent there, however, because he is just stopping by. Then everyone together decided to buy this one. It was really expensive to do both because this one cost $600. So that's going to be given six, or it's divided by 100, to Giraffe. But she no longer gets a payout from that building. Just totally bought it out. And then I think that's pretty much it. So everyone is safe at this courthouse now. Or civic building. I guess it's maybe a bus stop. Who knows what it is. Right, so both Flush and Banana start off employed. If you can see here, this is Banana's workplace. She's going to start off at home there. Also, if you go home, you can get your mail, and that's like a special card. So Flush is right here, and he would like to go to work here. So we'll roll him that way. Six. So he'll just go one, two. He could turn right. Three, four, five, six, and just stop right there. Banana made it to here, and Smudge came up and sold her a paper. Let's see what the paper says. And then we'll have to interpret its results. Okay, daily news. Major contracts awarded. This helps industry, small business, one and two, and factory. Add one development to each. Community-owned holdings benefit too. Add one development to United Travel Service Experts, one and two, and also to Community Power Company. Okay, I'm going to turn off the camera and decipher that and then see if anything happens. See, the problem is developments are things that people actually own. And right now, none of these things are, well, there's only this owned, and that wouldn't be... Yeah, I don't think that would be any of those things. Okay, so I suppose we could say this is a community power company. You know, it's a civic building. It's owned by the community, right? They all put in money into it. And remember, we have to try to assume that the newspaper is telling the truth. Can't add any. I'm not going to add developments into things that the Our Town players don't own because that would just be a further headache in deciphering what's going on the board. I did give a couple points to Stubby because he owns a lot of industry and he owns some small business. Actually, I should have only done one. And one to Junior because he owns the most commercial buildings. So just kind of a little bonus they got there for someone reading the newspaper. Since Pinky is currently our leader here in points and it's her turn, I thought maybe I should just show you what a turn looks like in the urban sprawl portion of the game, just so you know what that's about in case you haven't played it. So first she could sell these if she wants to. She's gonna not do that because she wants to use this permit right now. She kind of helps to develop what the plan of what you wanna do, and this is what she's going to do. She's gonna take, well, first she has to, she's gonna go ahead and build this bakery here, which costs her four APs, so she has two left. Now she has to build it right away, right? But normally I just kind of shorthand it and let them, you know, she's going to take this permit as well for two AP. She could have done that first. The reason she's taking that one is that she can sell that at her next turn for a lot of money. And that's useful. And then she's going to use this permit. So she's used up all her APs, two to get that, four to get that. She's going to take this permit and she's going to build a bakery. Now the bakery, it's too big. She needed two permits to do it. She has two permits. So she's going to take a two yellow. And I think, so she could put it here and get a couple prestige on it, and it would cost her seven, two plus five. See how it's combining there? So that's the value. But she sees that this thing's coming up, and she would like to be able to play off on that. She would like to get be able to dominate this zone. But still, I think this is going to be better. So she's going to go here. She will have to pay seven. And then build it. I'm going to pull out the money later. Whoops. Yeah, does that seem like a good place? So that puts her a little closer to having full control of the two zone here. The five zone, not much. She's just kind of jumping in there. She's kind of pretty much dominated this place and this right here. So she's spreading out. Now she could actually put it here too. But I think she would like to move into the two zone. So that's going to give her 3 points. 1, 2, 3. And I think that's going to be her turn. So what's going to happen next is we slide these down here. Zoom. And depending on what's revealed, something could happen. Okay, so we have an election. So we got to look at our election wheel. None of these elections, it says elect police chief. We don't get to do that until we're a city. There's no police chief yet. So this is just going to move over. Then we also do the same. Oh, we need to do an $11 payout. There is no 11 on the board. See these yellow things? So we don't have to do a payout. These are going to slide down. We might have to do a prestige payout depending on what this is. There's no payouts. And that's pretty much how a turn works. Next is going to be Giraffe's turn. I forgot to do the text on this card. So she gets a dollar for every other person who, or for people who have civ buildings and people who have comm buildings. That was the big reason she did this bakery. So it's kind of silly that I forgot to do that. So who has comm buildings? Well, Junior has 4 comm buildings, so he's got to pay her $4. Stubby has 2 comm buildings, commercial buildings, so he has to pay her 2. Giraffe is going to have to pay her 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, because she's got civ buildings and comm buildings. So Pinky's going to get quite a bit of money off of that turn. And the Giraffe's turn, a payout just occurred on the 6th square. Now that, or the 6th column, that includes this co-op here, and I decided that payout should also go to these players. Okay, since this is no longer owned by, or Giraffe no longer gets money for it, someone should if there's a payout. So they actually come in as a player by having control of those, but only in terms of money. Prestige doesn't matter. The prestige is gotten just by building the buildings. You get to put a plaque with your name on it, and so that's how you get prestige. So since it was community owned, that's going to go in a community fund. The community is going to have to vote on how to use it. So they have $200 now, which would be 2 in this game's currency. Each of these is worth 100. And Giraffe also became the mayor, which is fun. Stubby did something kind of fun. Now, for a while, Pinky has been just scoring big on having the most in this 3 prestige zone. Notice how far ahead she is from everyone else. Well, he put down a ranch here, which wasn't cheap, but he had a lot of money saved up. And that allowed him to take control of one of these. So that's going to put him at 3. He's rapidly gaining on her, and if he can build another building this turn, which he probably can, right? He could just build a house somewhere, or maybe a villa. Yeah, I think the villa would be nice. So if he builds that, and he has the AP to do it and the money, if he builds that, he can also place a park in here. So he's going to get 2 more control, and that's going to put him in the lead in the 3 zone. Okay, we went around with our town dwellers, and they're really starting to buy up quite a lot. It's going to be interesting to see how this affects the game. It'd probably be more interesting if I'd played Urban Sprawl on its own first, so I kind of knew how a game normally went, but I can kind of feel it a little bit. Our 2 homeowners are getting kind of broke. Flush almost. There was an instance where there was a high cost purchase. What was it? Oh, it was here. And it didn't divide. It divided up for them to each pay $120. Now, that's not possible with these denominations. So 2 people had to pay an extra $50. And that kind of Flush decided he would do it, but he was a little annoyed. So he was going to just buy these for himself, just to kind of, because he doesn't want to get out of the game, but he didn't even have enough money to do it, so he had to keep going along with other people. But just so you know, he's starting to feel that way. He's starting to feel like if he can grab something, he'll do it just to kind of get a little more cash flow just to himself. So that's what's going on. We're gonna have Smudge go ahead and move. He got a 9. He's right here. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. You know, that's probably close enough to sell a paper. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. No, not quite. But he's just going to park it there. No paper sold today. All right, here's the state of our city. It's going to be Pinky's turn, but we just were cleaning up after Junior's turn, and the airport card came up. So first we have to conduct elections for a bunch of stuff, and then... No, we're only going to do actually the things this says if this vote goes through. Okay, so we have business bribe. Business ready to offer low interest loans to create new industries in slum areas if there are no more riots. Okay, so What that means, if there are no riots right now, there's going to be some advantage for our slum players here, which would be those three. I think that's kind of what the upshot is. I don't know that that would really hurt business. A low interest loan, as long as they pay it back, it's not a problem. So I guess we'll just have to, that's kind of a weird kind of crisis for people to have to vote on, but I guess that's what it's going to be. So I got to do a little thinking, kind of got to refigure out what the rules are to this city's game, and then get back to you. Alrighty, so the negotiation has been done. So first what I did was I tried to figure out whether these fellows would like to go and become cities. They all had their town become a city. They all had reasons to do so. Giraffe, she's standing to get like a good bit of political roles by moving forward. Pinky's in the lead, so the sooner the game ends, the better for her. Everyone else had different reasons. They're all gonna, you know, the political grease is gonna be spread around to all of them. And so, I mean, Stubby, he's gonna get to have 8 action points a turn instead of 6. That's really attractive. The game is, city's game is kind of set up so that the government and business want things to progress at first, and then their payoff starts to go down as the others go up, and then when you get to the last one, it's the slum dwellers and the agitators who get the most. So they also wanted to go forward because, you know, this first one, they get their big payoff. So they had to come up with a way to kind of grease the wheels for everyone else, and they used the event as a guide in how to do that. They, to get the vote to pass, they need to have 6 or 7 and no riot votes, okay? Now, each of the two kind of underground factions gets 1 potential riot vote. However, they only get 1 police action vote, so they have to, police actions cancel out riots. So they have to essentially get at least 1 of them totally on board, and that's all they need. Because they, you know, if they agree, they only need 1 of the other 2 to agree. So they just gave each of these guys $1,000. This faction here, I guess all the urban sprawl people, they put together 1,000 between them. Bear in mind that each of these is worth 100 in their money. That led an odd number, and Giraffe was fine with putting in an extra dollar. But then they needed 1 more. No one would do it. So Giraffe because she was tired of the debate and the time was running out, she decided to just go ahead and put in another dollar. So she spent $4 of her own money. It didn't seem like that much, but it's pretty easy to get money, at least right now. It's going to get harder as these buildings get bought up. But anyway, that made Flush pretty happy to have an extra 1,000. He's no longer near doom. Sunny, they had to get 5,000 to because he's working on a very different scale. So with the business, Dancing Bear there gave Sunny 5,000. Chinky threw in 1,000 to pay off Banana, and Flush got paid off 1,000. So that's what happened. We're going to go forward into the city zone next time on the Real People Multi-Game Solitaire Mega Tournament. We are in the, what leg are we? English leg 3.03? Is that what we're doing? Yep. And we're moving up in the world, friends. Let's go.